Thank you for inviting me to this interesting panel. And I think this should have been called by the government. We had so many commissions, as Bharatbhai was talking about, Renge Commission and then Irate Commission. Those reports has never been executed. There have been so many recommendations, but nothing has happened. Some of the state government has taken initiative. They formed some boards. And I was going through the recommendations made by you through this report. I think if these recommendations reach to these state bodies, I think something could be done. But at moment, everyone is silent. No one is speaking about the DNT communities. Whatever news, whatever halla that you see is all about the migrant workers. No one knows that within the migrant workers, there is a large body of these denotified tribes and nomadic tribes. So since many of the participants or maybe the audience who are here to go through this data analysis that Praxis and National Alliance Group has together put it up together, a small survey, a frequent survey that they have done. Can you just go to the previous page? So I just want to introduce you that what does denotified tribe mean and what is a nomadic tribe? This has to be cleared out so that people who are audience just here who do not know about the denotified, so they should know about it. So denotified are basically the communities which were listed by the British under this 1871 Act, which was Criminal Tribe Act. So the communities were listed under that. They went through all kinds of struggles. And then this was repealed. I mean, this was uplifted. And then in 1952, these communities were denotified, but still the stigma of denotified that still links to their criminality background that was listed by the British. And now the nomadic communities are those tribes which are always on move, who are always roaming around because their profession is like that. For example, the Gadia Loha, so they do blacksmith work for the agriculturists. So they are always on the move. Similarly, they are genealogists, they are astrologer, they are entertainer, they are snake charmers, and so many service providers who has to move around, and those has been listed as nomadic tribe. But these both communities are still a problem to the government because they do not fall in their census so easily. Then they take their background as their identity still, matlab after independence, they are still identified with their historical background. So that is a big issue with these tribes. So this was a survey, a small survey that was conducted. I think it happened in the first week and second week of April, and it was conducted by some four or five organizations from different states. And it is good that the Praxis has given fellowships to some of the community members who have done this survey within their own communities. So the status is this, that the sample size of this survey has been 240 members. And in that 240 members, good that 50% are men and 50% are women. The people who has been interviewed are these are half 50%. It includes 22 denotified tribes and nomadic communities. The total number that our friend has given is like 198 communities were listed under the Criminal Tribe Act. So I think it's a good number that 22 communities has been surveyed over here in 28 districts in 10 states. So this data particularly relates to the wages, access to schemes, access to food, and indebtedness in context to the COVID situation that is happening, which is going right now. So so this has been mainly as because the movement was restricted, so this was done through mostly telephonic interviews, and then some small analysis has been put up here. So we'll go through this. Yeah, so you can see these circles, the states where the survey has taken place, maximum like Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Maharashtra. But the thing is that the nomadic communities are spread across from Kanyakumari to Leh Ladakh, from Rajasthan, Gujarat to Northeast. You'll find them everywhere, or you'll find the denotified tribes everywhere. And as I said, that the survey includes 50% male and 50% female, 22 communities. And you can see here that within these communities, there are 40% daily wage earners. Now, this is something that needs to be understood because most of the media is talking about the daily wage earners. So so within this committee, like almost 40% are daily wage earners. And then their big population is entertainers that you see on the roadsides, or you see in different forms, the entertaining the crowds all around. You can see them in festivals, you can see them in marriages, you can see them at different places, at different kind of involved in different kind of activities. Farmers are very few, because mostly the communities are landless. They are landless, so they are only 50% who are in who are into farming, and then they are into beggary, because a large chunk of community who has no option for livelihood finally settles to beggary. And in others, there's only 3% people. Yeah, so next slide. Yeah, so this is an analysis of the government schemes, which is Jan Dhan, which was in limelight when this government came in, and you have seen crowds outside banks to register under the Jan Dhan, and then nothing happened. But when this COVID happened, this Jan Dhan thing again came into limelight, and people were seen in big lanes outside the banks, standing in sun. And so 240 people who were interviewed, among them 124 were just registered, matlab 50% were registered under the Jan Dhan scheme. And among that 124, only 78 people received this 500 rupees in their accounts. Similarly, PDS, which is ration cards, most of the community member does not have ration card, because they either live in the outskirts of the villages or they are in the remote areas. So, but still in this survey, it has featured that 171 people were registered under PDS scheme, but you see only 36 people have received this ration from the government. Then Kisan Samman Nidhi is for the people who have lands. So among the 240 surveyors, 51 were registered under this scheme, and only 28 people got this. This is 2000. The amount is 2000 rupees that they get in three quarters. So that is that makes 6000. And similarly, like old age pension and disabled pension, so there were only 53 people who were registered in this 240 families, and among them 30 people got this pension, which is also, it ranges from 200 to 500 rupees according to age. And then Ujjala scheme is about getting free cylinders, which government popularized so much. But the truth over here with the denotified tribes and nomadic tribes is that only 83 people, 83 families were registered out of the 240. And from that too, only 38 families got free cylinders during the COVID situation. So this is quite a sad situation over here. Now, to cope up with the COVID situation, when you do not have food, you do not have ration, anything in the lockdown period, so what you will do? So then you have to take loans. So there's 51% people has taken loans to survive through this period. So the source of loan has been different people. So basically it is the traditional money lenders on whom they rely upon. So 40% has been taken from the money lenders or the employers, if they have been doing some work under some employer. And then from the friends, like 41% has come from friends or family. So for example, Rohini Chhara, she is speaking about the sex workers who have either returned or they are stuck in the cities. So earlier the situation was this, as I am aware of in a case from Bundi, that earlier the girls used to send money to their parents. But now what has happened during the COVID, that the parents has to send are sending the money to the girls in Bombay and big cities where they are settled. So this is a reverse cycle that is going on. And I know this money going from the village is definitely out of some indebtedness, must be the loan from the money lenders. So this is going to create a big situation post COVID, and how this money will be returned will be a big problem to these communities basically. Then 11% has taken from maybe from banks or shops, and 8% has not given any answer. So reason for loan, basically you can see as the situation is that 82% of these loan has been taken only for the reason for the food, and 4% for medicines, and then for farming, those who have farms, and 5% others. Next. So this is another data of a daily wage workers. There are some 100 respondents among these communities who are into daily wage earnings. Sasi, Bavaria, Vedia, Nut, Mushar, Kaikadi, Kaloder, Kheria Sabbar, Vadar, and Bacha. So total among the 100 who did not get ration, like 82, it's a big number that we have not got any dry ration from the government during this COVID situation. Receiving income from at least one government scheme like Jan Dhan, pension or Kisan Samman, only 33% people has, or 33% has received this money from the Kisan Samman Nidhi. Did not get 3 meals in a day for at least one day. So there have been many community members who have just eaten once in a day for almost a week or two till the help came from mostly from the NGOs, from the civil society, or maybe from the donors. Actually, government has reached very late to these people. Have taken a loan, like 22 people out of 79 who have answered, they have taken loan. So the situation is quite sad, and because as you know with these communities, the main issue is that they do not have document to claim citizenship. Now, for example, government has opened the transportation, and people who want to go to their base camps, maybe, or to their homes, native places, they have to register now. Now, to register, you need a document. If you do not have a document, how you can go? This will be an impossible thing now. A few days back, I was seeing a video of a Kalbelia community. Someone has shared that video, and the person belongs to Bundi, and all the way from Bangalore, he has traveled on cycle because he has a mother who is 80, 85 years. So how could he bring her along? So he took a bicycle, and on bicycle he put his mother, drove throughout from Bangalore to Bundi, and he had 4-5 kids. So they all walked on foot, and he has just dragged the cycle. He has not paddled the cycle. He has dragged the cycle just to put his mother on back of the cycle. So this is the situation with these communities. Similarly, yesterday I received a call from a village, which is a big village of genealogists. So this is a time for such communities that they go to the farmers who are basically after the crop harvest, they collect their earning, because these are service communities who provide certain kind of services to the villagers. So to go to their patrons, like what we call jajmans, they visit during this period. Now in the lockdown situation, they cannot go. Same is the situation with the traditional musicians who are also nomadic communities and denotified tribes. They also come under the same category. They cannot visit their patrons because there is a complete lockdown. So these people have suffered badly during this situation, and I do not know where it will lead post-COVID, because these communities will definitely not fall in the attention of the present government, or maybe the policy makers. So some voice need to be raised over here. For that, for example, Bharat Bhai was saying that Idate should have been invited over here. So I think if we plan more webinars like this involving public figures, or maybe the politicians, then I think it will make little sense that they will get to know what situation is going on right now. Thank you very much. Thank you, Praxis, for giving me a chance to speak here. Thank you, and sharing your data. It's a wonderful work, and I congratulate all the surveyors and the people who has done this wonderful analysis. Wish you all the best. Thank you.